Hi everyone, this is Donna Glover. Welcome to this month's Labor and Employment Coffee Chat. This month we're talking about new Maryland employment laws, so a little bit of a roundup on the legislative session that closed in April of 2019. And just those few key reminders that we do every month with you. There is a Q&A box for questions. If I don't get to all of them during the session, I will follow up afterwards. We love your feedback, so please complete the survey. We will definitely send you a copy of the presentation when we send you our thank you email, so look for that in the coming days. And of course, you can always connect with us via social media at the bottom of your screen. So let's get started and take a look at some new Maryland laws. Now, I know you all probably heard about the minimum wage law, but there were actually a few others that we'll talk about today. And one of them is we now have a Maryland Department of Labor because it was renamed from the Department of Labor Licensing and Regulation, which we all know as the DLLR and some folks call dollar. So the DLLR, as of July 1, 2019, will now be known as the Maryland DOL or the Maryland Department of Labor. So that is a new law that certainly doesn't have any impact on your business, but I just wanted you to be aware of the name change in case you get any documents or mailings from the newly named DOL. Of course, the minimum wage law, which was the big battle in this session, you are probably all familiar with or have heard about. So we've joined a number of other states and local jurisdictions in adopting a $15 minimum wage that will be phased in over time. So the current minimum wage in Maryland is $10.10. And starting on January 1, 2020, employers are going to have to phase in certain minimum wage increases over a certain period, 6 or 7 years, depending on the size of your business. So here's how that looks. So for employers with 15 or more employees, there's your schedule. So as of January 1, 2020, you will have an $11 minimum wage, and you can see how it ticks up across the years until we hit January 1, 2025, when we're at $15. Now, to complicate matters just a little, for those of you who have businesses or employees who work in Montgomery County and or PG County, and they have a different scale, and they have their own minimum wages in Montgomery County and PG County. So you have to make sure that you are providing the greater benefit of the two laws. So Montgomery County, for example, their current minimum wage is $12.25 per hour, and that'll last through June 30. And then that goes to $13 on July 1, 2019. So clearly at that moment, you're above the new Maryland minimum wage that takes effect January 1, 2020. And then they creep up in Montgomery County to $14 on July 1, 2020. So you get another hit there. So you'll already be at 14 in Montgomery County. PG County has a different scale. And both Montgomery and PG County also go by size of employer. So if you're not familiar with their minimum wage laws and how they work, because they were all recently amended not too long ago, you should take a fresh look at that and how it impacts your business. The other thing I'll say about the two county laws that some people get confused on, you do not have to have a physical location in Montgomery or PG County to be covered by their laws. So if you have employees who regularly work in that county, you would be subject to their laws and off topic, but that would also include the Montgomery County sick leave law. That's how that law works as well. In other words, you do not need to have a physical location there. Okay, so if you're 15 or more, that's your scale. If you're fewer than 15, this is your scale. So it's a longer stretch to get to 15, So small employers don't have to hit the mark until July 1 of 2026. So they have a little bit more time in the creep to get up to the $15 minimum wage. Now, having said that, I'm just going to remind you again about Montgomery and PG because they have different scales by size of employer. So you always want to be cross-checking against those county laws if you have employees or physical locations in those counties. Now, a new aspect here is under a couple things. Under the Fair Labor Standards Act somewhat under Maryland law, but under the Fair Labor Standards Act, you can pay a training wage. And under Maryland law, you can pay, current Maryland law, you can pay 85% of the state minimum wage rate to employees who are younger than age 20 for the first 6 months of their employment, or to employees who work in certain industries like amusement, recreational, swimming pool establishments. So that's gone. You can no longer do that under Maryland law. In other words, you can't pay a training wage even though it's federally okay to do that. Maryland minimum wage law doesn't allow that. But businesses can pay workers under the age of 18 now, not 20, 18, a minimum wage equal to 85% of the state's minimum wage. So basically the age dropped and there's no longer what we might classify as a training wage. So that's a new feature. There's also some tipped provisions if you are in the industry where you have tips or used a tipped wage. The newly named Department of Labor is supposed to come out with regulations regarding tipped workers and how the tipped wage works under the new minimum wage. So we'll be looking for that information, hopefully in the near future. Okay, so that is the new minimum wage law. Now, the next one we're going to talk about, I think you all know that Maryland has a separate equal pay for equal work law. That particular law was recently amended with what I like to call a pay transparency provision. And that pay transparency provision says that you cannot prohibit employees from talking about their wages, asking about their wages, disclosing their wages to other employees, or coming to talk to you about why they're paid what they're paid. If you're a federal contractor, there's a similar executive order on this type of pay transparency requirement. And Maryland law was also amended around that time to change up a little bit about how they analyzed or looked at pay discrepancies or pay discrimination between the sexes and or gender identity for employees who are working in the same establishment and performing comparable work. So the definitions changed a little bit in terms of what is an establishment and what is performing comparable work. So it became a little tougher on employers under the amended equal pay law. So this year, what they did was took a look at, okay, how many violations have we dealt with at the Department of Labor? You know, how many complaints have we gotten and, you know, resolved or gone after the employer for violations of the equal pay for equal work law? And once they did that, the bill that was in session was a bill that would penalize employers with basically, I would call it a civil penalty. And if you violate the law at least two times in a three-year period, then you would not only be liable for the damages with respect to the wages, and of course in Maryland, triple damages would be on the table under our wage and hour law. Under federal law, it's double damages. You would also be liable for a 10% penalty, 10% of the amount of the damages, like the wages owed, to the employee. That payment would go into the general fund of the state to offset costs of enforcing the equal pay for equal work law. That is effective October 1 of 2019. Interestingly enough, a number of laws this year were not signed by the governor. So if the governor doesn't sign it or veto it within 30 days of what we call presentment to the governor for signature, if he does nothing with it, then it becomes a law by what we call operation of law under our constitution, under the state constitution. And this was one of those laws that became a law by operation of law. So he didn't sign it or veto it, didn't do anything with it. But now we have it as a law. So that is the equal pay for equal work. Okay, now an interesting one that also came into being by operational law was the non-compete and conflict of interest clause law. So this particular law prohibits non-competes and conflict of interest restrictions on certain level jobs effective October 1, 2019. So here's how that's going to work. Under this new law, you cannot have a non-compete that restricts an employee from working for a new employer or becoming self-employed in the same or similar business if the employee earns $15 per hour or the equivalent of $31,200 annually or less. So thinking of it hourly, $15 per hour or less, or on an annualized basis, $31,200 or less. So if you have non-competes in place for that level of employee, meaning you can't go to work for someone in our industry or compete with us in our industry within a certain geographic region, as of October 1 of this year, that is an invalid document. It becomes void, and it no longer has effect. So you would not be able to hold those employees under those agreements any longer, because that would be against the law now in the state of Maryland. So importantly, that non-compete restriction is different from, and you probably know this, but it's different from a non-solicitation provision or a confidentiality provision. Now, under the law, like if you're trying to enforce these restrictive covenants, whether it's a non-compete and non-solicitation or a confidentiality agreement, they're all analyzed the same, right? Are they reasonable? You know, do they make sense? And do they tie to the person's job, or are they just some broad, you know, broad language that is not narrowly tailored enough to make it enforceable? So the courts look at all these the same. But under this non-compete law, it does not apply to those kinds of provisions that would prevent a person from, you know, taking client names, a client list, a prospect list, or other proprietary client-related information. So you can still have, for this level of an employee, you can still have those types of restrictions. You cannot have a non-compete that would restrict them from working in your industry, you know, within a certain geography or however your agreements might describe it. And importantly, this restriction applies whether or not the agreement was entered into in Maryland. So for example, if this is a Virginia employer, right, who has employees working in Maryland under a non-compete, and they're at these certain hourly rate or salary levels, it doesn't matter that the contract was signed in Virginia. The application of it is in Maryland, and that would be unlawful under this new law. So that is the non-compete and conflict of interest law. The next one is called prevailing wage rates for public work contracts, suits by employees. And a colleague of mine, Mike Scallard, and I wrote an article on this. So there's a ton more information on our website that speaks to, okay, so what should contractors and subcontractors be thinking about with respect to compliance with this law and protecting themselves against, you know, suits brought by employees. But generally, as you may know, especially if you're not a federal contractor or a state contractor, when you are a contractor at the state level, there are certain prevailing wage rates that you have to pay that are determined by the state under a wage determination. And you have to pay those wages properly. You have to pay overtime properly, you know, all those things. If an employee is not properly paid, in the past, they would file a complaint with the now newly named Maryland Department of Labor, and it would go down that route. And the state could sue on behalf of the employee, and the employee could always sue, right, under regular old Maryland wage and hour law that says you have to properly pay people and overtime and all that. But now the employees have a right to file a lawsuit without first going through the Maryland Department of Labor for their wages they claim are due them. The fact that a contractor fixed the problem, you know, and we call that made restitution under the prevailing wage provisions, it does not stop the person from suing the employer for their wages, even if you tried to make restitution to fix it. And importantly, just like last year when there was a law passed that said general contractors are liable, strictly liable, for their subcontractors' errors in making wage payments and overtime payments under the regular Maryland wage and hour law. That happened last year. Now that same provision applies to prevailing wage rates. So a general contractor who hires a subcontractor and the subcontractor violates this law, the general contractor is liable for the damages caused by the subcontractor. As I said, there's much more information on our website about this because it does heavily impact contractors and how they go about their business. So we do encourage you to take a look at that. And if you are a contractor, in terms of the state prevailing wages, be looking at what you can do to shore up your contracts to protect on these issues. Okay, we also have another new law, organ donation leave. This law has two parts. One says that, you know, insurers can't discriminate against those who, participate in organ donation. And it also provides that employers have to give employees unpaid leave for organ donation. So this one's effective October 1, 2019. The insurance provisions are come in a little later. So if you are an insurer, for example, of life, disability, or long-term care insurance, those provisions go into effect in 2020, not October 1, 2019. But effective October 1 of this year, if you have 15 or more employees, you have to provide unpaid organ and or bone marrow donation leave, as you see here. So up to 60 days for organ donation within a 12-month period, up to 30 days for bone marrow in that 12-month period. And an eligible employee under the law is defined as someone who has 12 months of service and 1,250 hours actually worked, prior to the start of the leave. Now that should sound familiar if you're an FMLA-covered employer, because that's the criteria for eligibility under the Family and Medical Leave, the Federal Family and Medical Leave Act. But interestingly, this law says that you cannot run the organ donation or bone marrow donation leave concurrently with FMLA. So that's not permissible under this law. So this leave stands on its own, and you can't run it concurrently with FMLA. So I thought that was particularly interesting. That they added that provision to the law. So a little bit more on organ donation. The leave itself can't be considered to be a break in service for purposes like a salary adjustment or sick leave accruals or vacation PTO accruals or seniority. You have to maintain group health coverage during the leave, which is also interesting because typically you only have to do that unless if your policies provide for it, or if it is an FMLA-covered leave. You have to pay any commissions that come due during the leave. So if I'm 100% commission employee, whatever I worked up until the leave, if my commissions come due during the leave, you have to pay them to me during my leave. And there are also return to work rights for employees they have to be returned to the same or equivalent employment, same benefits, pay, and other terms of, and conditions of employment at the conclusion of the leave. On the enforcement side, our newly named Department of Labor is supposed to adopt regulations about how they're going to handle investigation of violations when they get a complaint from an employee. And under the new law, they're going to try to resolve it via, you know, a mediation attempt, sort of a voluntary process. But they can also ask the Attorney General's office to bring a lawsuit on behalf of the employee if the employer and the Department of Labor aren't able to work it out. Also, employers cannot violate provisions of the leave program. Of course, you can't violate the law, but you can't interfere with an employee's need to use the leave. And of course, you can't retaliate against someone who accesses their rights under the law and uses leave or requests leave, et cetera. All right. Oh, there we go. Okay. All right. Let me keep going here. Oh, sorry. So those are all the new laws that we have in Maryland. And, you know, last year, if you recall, the only new law we had of any substance other than, you know, the general contractor strict liability under the wage and hour law was the sick leave law. So in addition to minimum wage, we did get a few others that I actually was not expecting us to see, but several of those, as I mentioned, came by operation of law. The governor just didn't do anything once the bill was presented. He didn't sign or vetoed. So I thought we'd take a look at, with our time that's left, some of the things that were left on the table that we're likely to see coming up in the next session. And so I'll walk you through those now. So the first one is actually a vetoed law. This actually got through in session to what we called an enrolled status, and it was presented to the governor for signature, and he vetoed it. He actually wrote a letter about his veto that you can find on the General Assembly's website if you're interested in reading it. But he basically said employers should be left to this task, and the state should not be mandating when or how an employer can do a criminal record screening with respect to hiring an employee. So you all know these as ban the box laws. Many local jurisdictions have them. In Maryland, Baltimore City has a ban the box law. Montgomery County has a ban the box law. PG County has a ban the box law. And many states and other local jurisdictions around the country have them as well, including the District of Columbia. So if this had been enacted and not vetoed, it would have applied to employers with 15 or more employees. It would prevent you from conducting a criminal history check or asking about criminal history until you made a conditional offer. You would be able to require an applicant to tell you in the first in-person interview, though, whether they had a criminal record, which I thought was interesting and a little odd, frankly, because if you can't really ask about it till after making a conditional offer, why are we allowed to do it in an interview? But that gives the employer a little more leeway. And it was a sort of a civil penalty enforcement provision. There was no right to sue under this law. That's also how, for example, DC works. There's no right to sue under their ban the box law. It's basically a set of civil fines if you're called to task on it. And it would have taken effect January 1 of 2020, but the governor stamped it veto. We probably, and I think definitely, will see this one come back. And to be honest, I did not check the vote tally to see if there's possibly enough for a veto override when the session opens next January, but that's a possibility. But I think we'll definitely see this one come back one way or the other. Okay, so we also had a couple of bills related to the Maryland Healthy Working Families Act. This one would have allowed employers who have an on-site health clinic to escape the provisions of the Healthy Working Families Act. And you can see in the bill, they gave an example of Bowie State University, with particularly student workers. So I do think the educational employers were probably driving this particular bill because student workers qualify for Healthy Working Family Act sick leave just like everybody else does. So the idea here would have been if there's an on-site health clinic, I, as an employer, wouldn't have to comply with the sick and safe leave under the Maryland Healthy Working Families Act. So that one died in session. We also had one related to the Healthy Working Families Act on an absence control policy. And this one would have allowed an employer to apply such an absence policy if you gave at least 40 hours of paid leave in a year, including the sick leave, and if the policy applied to all types of leave, was communicated in writing, had a progressive structure, like a progressive discipline under it, and provided warnings to employees before any possible action against an employee. Now, you might know, if you're familiar with the sick and safe leave law in Maryland, there's a no retaliation provision. And under that no retaliation provision, it says you cannot use sick leave use against the employee for purposes of an attendance control or performance or any other reason. So that would be retaliatory. So if I get my 40 hours under the Healthy Working Families Act and I use it, you cannot use that against me at all under the Maryland law. So this would have eased up on that provision, but this also died in session. All right, we had also one with respect to seasonal workers. I'm sure if you are a seasonal employer, you know how hard it is to deal with the sick leave law in Maryland, the way it's structured. But what this would have done is it would have changed the rehire provision from 37 weeks to 32 weeks, but it would have changed the restricted period for new hires from 106 to 120 days. So let me just explain that a little bit. Under Maryland law, right now, you can, as an employer, restrict use of accrued sick leave under the law to the 107th day, calendar day of employment. This would have given employers a little more room in the hopes, I think, that summer employees, seasonal or temporary workers, wouldn't get to that 120 calendar day period because they're just not around long enough. So it would have been probably a cost savings for employers who had these types of workers regularly in the summer. But this one also did not go anywhere in session. There was also a family and medical leave insurance program called the Time to Care Act. For those of you who maybe operate in DC, this is very similar to the DC Universal Paid Leave Act, which the tax collection starts effective July 1 of this year, 2019. So if you are in DC and you haven't looked at that, you should be. Because you have to pay taxes on wages for the April, May, June quarter. And then benefits kick in DC in 2020, July 2020. California has a law like this. New York has a law like this. So this was Maryland's version, which did not get passed. But it would have established a program that gave employees 12 weeks of leave benefits for caring for themselves, family members, or some kind of emergency situation arising out of military deployment. The benefit would have been capped based on an average weekly wage. This is very similar to how DC works. It would establish the fund where the monies would have been collected. In Maryland, it would have consisted of employer and employee contributions based on an employee's gross wages. In DC, FYI, it's totally an employer cost. So employers in DC have to foot the bill there. And it would have gone into effect in June 1, with contributions beginning in 2020. So that did not pass as well. All right. Labor organizations' right to work. We see this one pretty regularly. It'll probably come back again. But if it had been enacted, it would have specified that an employer doesn't have to require the condition of employment to join a union, remain a union member, basically a right to work provision that are that is around in many other states. Probably about 30 states have right to work laws. We do not in Maryland, but this particular bill also died in session. We also had an employers of ex-offenders looking at the liability for negligent hiring or inadequate supervision. This would have given employers a bit of protection there, that they would not have been held liable for negligently hiring or adequately supervising an employee who had come out of prison or had received probation for judgment for an offense if they had completed their term, their prison term, been released on parole, and worked in certain industries. That also obviously did not pass. Okay. There was also a bill, and this may sound familiar because there was a Supreme Court case decision on this last year. There was a bill for an overtime exemption regarding service advisors. And, of course, service advisors are those who, sell services on automobiles. You know, for example, you go to your car shop, you talk with your guy who knows your car well, and he's your service advisor, and he's managing, the repairs on your car. The Supreme Court recently held that those employees were exempt under the Fair Labor Standards Act. So Maryland was taking a stab at that, and it would have exempted employers from having to pay overtime to service advisors if for pay overtime wages of at least 1.5 times their wage rate if they are primarily selling services for automobiles, et cetera, as you can see, and they are, in like the car shop at the car dealer and not in a, manufacturing setting of automobiles, et cetera. So that one went nowhere, but that was already sort of taken care of by the Supreme Court in that decision last year. There was also a bill up to restrict employers from asking about wage history, wage ranges. This is happening a lot across the country in various jurisdictions. New York is one of them that comes to mind pretty quickly. But this is one of those, you can't ask for those salary histories in connection with looking at an applicant. You can't request it, can't require it on the application, et cetera. That did not get passed. I think we're going to see that one again next year because that's a pretty heavy trend. We also had four bills, count them four, on discrimination protections for medical marijuana users and caregivers. Just a note on this. Now, under Maryland law, we currently do not have any protections against discrimination for those who carry medical marijuana cards. The card itself gives you nothing as a protection in connection with employment. If there is an underlying disability and you fail to hire, for example, someone who has an underlying disability and you know about that, and they also have a medical marijuana card, I think the argument is going to be they fired me because of my disability or they didn't hire me because of my disability. So in Maryland, just to be clear, there's no protection from discrimination just because I have a card. So we saw a lot of activity on this with nothing that came out of it. This first particular bill would have prohibited you from discriminating against a qualifying patient, like an employee with a card, or a caregiver, maybe an employee who assists someone with a card, in hiring or termination or any other condition of employment based on their status, as having a card or being a caregiver, et cetera. This one went absolutely nowhere. And it was a civil fine for violations of this particular law. There was no right to sue. Employees would not have received that under this law. This one, screening for use of marijuana or cannabis, would have applied to 15 employers with 15 or more full-time employees, and it would have prohibited employers from requiring applicants or employees to disclose marijuana use or asking about marijuana use. Employers would have been able to inquire about marijuana use if it was required by another law, like maybe Department of Transportation. And employers would be able to make inquiries of applicants or employees if they were, obviously using during work hours, possessing, or impaired. I think what this was intending to do was to take the right out of the employer's hand to test for marijuana when, you know, either post-accident or time of hire or as an applicant, that was taking marijuana off the table, even though it is a federally illegal drug. It's a Schedule I drug, which is the highest level or most serious levels of drugs under the federal scheme. We also had another one, discrimination against medical cannabis patients and caregivers. So similar to the other one we looked at, this is almost exactly the same. It was just a Senate bill version of it. So that was the third one. And then the fourth one is discrimination in employment for use of medical marijuana. And it would have, this one probably would have had the most bang for the buck for those who want to protect medical marijuana users, but would prohibit discrimination on the basis of the card itself or a positive drug test for medical marijuana, provided they're a cardholder. That raises a lot of questions in my mind, probably yours too. So that went nowhere, but I can almost guarantee we're seeing some of these bills come up again because medical marijuana is such a huge trend. And I regularly talk with clients about this issue and how difficult it is to kind of weed through what to do when somebody produces that card. Okay, we also had a bill that would have raised the salary basis threshold to $900 weekly or $46,800 annually to be considered exempt under the administrative, executive, or professional exemptions under Maryland law, called the Overtime Modernization Act. And this failed, but as you know, sitting out there is the U.S. DOL's proposed rule on a new overtime threshold. So thankfully, we did not see this in Maryland, but we are still awaiting what the DOL is going to do regarding that new rule. And if I'm recalling correctly, I think it is still in the comment period. I think they went back for a second comment period for that particular overtime rule under federal law. We also, a couple more to cover with you. We had a human relations employment discrimination bill that would have revised the size of employer with respect to our Fair Employment Practices Act. So in Maryland, like most states, except for Mississippi, I think, there's a Fair Employment Practices Law, which is basically the state's anti-discrimination law. So we call them FEPAs. And under Maryland's FEPA, in order for an employer to be covered by that law, you have to have 15 or more employees. And this particular bill would have decreased that to 5 employees. And it also would have extended the time for filing a complaint under Maryland law from currently 6 months to 18 months. It would have given a person a lot more time. And as you might know, Maryland and most states have work share agreements with the Federal Equal Employment Opportunity Commission. So in most jurisdictions, the employee has 300 days from the time of the alleged discriminatory act to file their claim. But if you're looking at it strictly from a Maryland state point of view, our limitation is 6 months or 180 days. So this would have purported to extend that to 18 months. A similar but different approach was another bill that would have dropped Maryland's FEPA coverage down to any employer who had at least one employee. Montgomery County has its own anti-discrimination law, as does PG County and other counties in Maryland. So when you're thinking about what laws you're covered by, if you are operating in Maryland, it's not just Maryland's state Fair Employment Practices Act. You do need to look to the county laws as well, and their employee thresholds are much lower. If I'm remembering correctly, I think Montgomery County is one employee. So if you operate in Montgomery County or if you have employees working there, that law would also cover you and your employees in those jurisdictions. So that may be similar in other states as well when you think about what the laws are that you have to comply with. you should be thinking beyond, you know, federal and state and looking at your local jurisdictions as well. All right, we also had a discrimination in employment, pregnancy, and childbirth. You may remember a few years ago, it might be more than a few now, Maryland enacted a pregnancy accommodation law. It was an amendment to the Fair Employment Practices Act that gives pregnant workers more rights than they would have, for example, under the Americans with Disabilities Act, with respect to medical conditions that are associated with the pregnancy. This particular bill would have required employers to provide employees with leave or other accommodations for disabilities that's the current law, my apologies, which I just described. And this law would have required employers to provide you, your employees, with accommodations more broadly. It would have been limitations arising out of pregnancy or childbirth. So current law is disability due to, which is a direct connection. It's not just because I'm pregnant, I have to have a separate disability due to the pregnancy or due to the childbirth under current law. Under this bill, it would have broadened it to limitations arising out of, which is much more broad than an actual disability. It would have also expanded current law to protect applicants, not just employees. And it would also add that employers couldn't require pregnant workers to take leave or force them to take any particular accommodation if no limitation exists or no accommodation is necessary. Well, frankly, you wouldn't want to do that anyway, because you don't want to treat a worker as if they're disabled or as if they have a limiting condition when they don't. But I think the message there was, or attempted to be, you know, don't just put pregnant workers out on leave. They can do other stuff for you, right? Which we all know, but this law was trying to really tamp down on that you can't just push pregnant workers out on leave versus figuring out how to accommodate them. Okay, and then we also had a bill that failed called Employers of Ex-Offenders, Liability for Negligent Hiring or Inadequate Supervision. This was very similar to the other version we just went through, so I won't belabor it, but this one failed as well in session. Finally, I think this might be our last one, or we're getting close, right? This one would have allowed a county to establish a minimum wage. I think there's a real push in Maryland, just like we did with the sick leave bill, or the legislative body did with the sick leave bill, right? Montgomery County already had a sick leave law in place, and the state was considering it. PG had one on the table, PG County. They held back until they saw what the state did. So when the state enacted the sick and safe leave law, they said, okay, there's a provision in that law that says no other county can do what Montgomery County did, because it just gets too darn hard for employers to comply. And we have a similar problem on the minimum wage side. As I talked about earlier, we have a state minimum wage, we have PG County minimum wage, and Montgomery County minimum wage. This would have said, okay, counties, go for it. You can establish any minimum wage you would like for those employees who are working in your county. This failed, and I hope it never comes back, because it's complicated enough to comply with all of these laws, much less figuring out the scales between the counties and the state minimum wage. So that brings us to a close on our presentation. I'm going to take a quick look, because we have a couple of minutes, to see if we have any questions that I can answer for you. Let's see. Hold on 1 second. Okay, so our question is, if your headquarters is in Baltimore, and I'll assume that's maybe Baltimore County, but it could be Baltimore City, in Baltimore, but have remote employees in PG or Montgomery, what minimum wage do they need to be paid? Great question. So you always, for Montgomery and PG, the way their laws operate is that if the employee is working primarily in Montgomery County or PG, you have to pay the minimum wages of those counties. If you need additional information on that, they should have decent resources on their websites about the definition of employee under those minimum wage laws. But generally, if they're primarily working their duties in those jurisdictions, they're covered by those minimum wages and not the states. So that one is a great question. Let's see if we can figure out another one here. Can the organ donation leave be run consecutively then? So I think the person might be asking, because I mentioned that the organ donation leave cannot run concurrently with FMLA. So what I mean by that is, you know, you get 12 weeks of FMLA. Let's say I take organ donation leave, and it's 60 days. My 60 days cannot fit into the FMLA 12-week window. The law does not allow it, the Maryland law. So I might take my 60 days of organ donation leave, and then at the end of that, if I'm still not healthy enough to return to work, take my FMLA leave, or vice versa. The law does not address what has to come first. What the law says is you can't run them together. It's a separate leave period that the employee gets for organ donation. And with that, we are out of time. I thank you for your participation today. If I didn't get to your question, I'll make sure to follow up via email. And we look forward to you joining us next month. We are going to talk about the DC Universal Paid Leave Act and all of the intricacies of that, because you, as with many laws in DC, you don't have to have a physical location there to be covered by that law. If you are covered by unemployment in DC, like one person working in DC, regardless of whether or not you have a physical location, you are covered by the DC Universal Paid Leave Act. So we'll fill you in on that next month. Thanks, everybody, and have a great week.